The United Nations overwhelmingly approving a resolution calling for a humanitarian truce between Israel and Hamas and demanding aid access to Gaza. This is the UN's first response to the war in the Middle East. The document, drafted by Arab states, is not binding but carries political weight. The 193-member world body adopted the resolution by a vote of 120-14 with 45 abstentions. The Philippines is among those who abstained, citing a need to show neutrality in the conflict. Israel and the U.S. are among those who voted against. Israel's ambassador to the U.N. slammed the U.N.'s move.
Today is a day that will go down in infamy. We have all witnessed that the U.N. no longer holds even 1 ounce of legitimacy or relevance. This organization was founded in the wake of the Holocaust for the purpose of preventing atrocities. Yet, the spectacle we just saw proves beyond a doubt that the UN is committed, sadly, tragically, not to preventing but ensuring further atrocities. Israel has the right to defend itself, and the realization of this right is to ensure that such atrocities are never repeated. The only way to ensure this is the eradication of Hamas's terror capabilities.
The Palestinian ambassador called the General Assembly more courageous and more principled than the divided UN Security Council, which failed 4 times to reach an agreement on a resolution.
We are grateful that the General Assembly prevailed and sent the appropriate message, not only to the Palestinian people, that there is justice and fairness and international humanitarian law upholded by the General Assembly, but also it sent the message to everyone, enough is enough, this war has to stop, the carnage against our people has to stop, and humanitarian assistance should begin to enter the Gaza Strip with at least 100 truckloads of humanitarian assistance.
Philippines' ambassador and permanent representative to the UN on Friday said he finds the UN resolution, calling for a humanitarian truce between Israel and Hamas lacking. In a statement, Philippines envoy to the UN, Antonio Lagdameo, explained, while the Philippines condemns all killings and terror attacks happening, the resolution failed to mention or condemn the October 7 Hamas attack, which led to the death of hundreds of civilians. But Lagdameo added, the Philippines fully supports the efforts of the UN to deliver urgent humanitarian assistance to Palestinian civilians trapped in the Gaza Strip. Meanwhile, the Philippine Foreign Affairs Department, for its part, says they continue to applaud the UN's efforts to address the deepening humanitarian crisis between Israel and Gaza. Hamas vows to counter Israeli attacks in full force after Israel stepped up its air and ground raids in Gaza. In a statement on Saturday, Hamas expressed its resistance against Israel's continuing aggression. Palestinian health authorities reported Israeli bombings have already killed more than 7,000 Palestinians. Meanwhile, Israeli forces have amassed outside Gaza, where troops have been conducting an intense campaign of aerial bombardment following the October 7 Hamas attack. The Israeli military accusing Hamas of using Gaza's main hospital as a control center for its operations. Israel's chief military spokesperson asserts Hamas terrorists are currently operating inside Gaza's Al-Shifa hospital.
Hamas has turned hospitals into command and control centers and hideouts for Hamas terrorists and commanders. Additionally, I can confirm that according to the intelligence we have in our hands, there is fuel in hospitals in Gaza. It is here in Shifa Hospital where Hamas operates some of its command and control cells. This is where the direct rocket attacks command Hamas forces. Hamas terrorists operate inside and under Shifa Hospital and other hospitals in Gaza with network of terror tunnels.
Meanwhile, the Palestinian armed group Hamas rejected Israel's claims, saying there is no basis in their allegations. The fourth batch of Filipino repatriates from Israel expected to arrive on Monday. Philippine migrant workers under Secretary Hans Leo Cacdac says around 60 Filipinos are part of that batch. Cacdac adds more Filipinos in Israel and Lebanon have requested for repatriation. The DMW says they are prepared once the ongoing tensions in the Middle East worsen.
Merong mga crisis plans, contingency plans in place. Halimbawa sa Israel na ay magpapadala na tayo ng augmentation team, pati yung mga evacuation and repatriation routes, no? Hindi ko lang dedetalyehin. Meron na rin tayong preparasyon doon.
As we reported earlier, more Filipinos are set to return to the Philippines from war-torn Israel. A repatriation flight from Lebanon is also being mounted. Let's get more details from Katrina Domingo, who joins us on the line. Kat.
Hi, Rita. Let's talk about Israel first. The Philippines is set to repatriate 62 Filipinos from the war-torn country, bringing the total number of Filipino nationals who wish to flee the Middle Eastern conflict to 123. That's according to Department of Migrant Workers Officer in Charge Hans Cacdac, who says that the fourth repatriation flight from Tel Aviv will arrive in Manila next week, and it will carry 32 hotel workers, 28 caregivers, and 2 infants. He says that the Philippine government is making the most out of commercial flights while the Ben-Gurion International Airport is still open for commercial airlines. Cacdac says while there are contingency plans in place in case Israel's main airport is closed, the safest and most accessible means for transportation still remains to be via air. Now, just like other overseas Filipino workers who returned to the country from Israel earlier this month, the new batch of repatriates would also receive cash aid from the DMW, the Overseas Workers Welfare Administration, the Social Welfare Department, as well as the Department of Labor and Employment. Cacdac says that while the DMW has an employment facilitation program, the priority is for these OFWs to remain to return to their employers once the situation settles down in Israel. He says 99% of the 30,000 OFWs in Israel are caregivers, while the remaining 1% accounts for hotel staff working there. The Philippine government is also coordinating with the Israel Defense Forces to gather more information about the status of 2 Filipinos who remain unaccounted for still up to this day. Rika, Cacdac explains that the areas where the 2 Filipinos are expected to be located in have been marked as no-enter zones, which is why the Philippines doesn't have a clear picture as to their status, if they are still alive, if they have been abducted by Hamas militants. Now, over in Lebanon, Rica, where Israeli forces are combating another militant group called the Hezbollah, the Philippines is also mounting its first repatriation flight from Beirut for 124 OFWs who wish to return home. Cacdac says that flight may be mounted this coming week. And he adds that the Philippine government will also be sending an augmentation team to Israel to help in the processing of OFWs who wish to leave the war-torn country. Rika.
Comprehensive report coming from you. Katrina Domingo reporting live. Thank you. An analyst says America's strikes on Syria are a message to Iran not to escalate the Gaza conflict. The U.S. military carried out strikes against 2 facilities in eastern Syria used by Iran's Revolutionary Guard Corps on Thursday. President Joe Biden ordered the strikes in response to a spate of attacks against U.S. forces in Iraq and Syria.
I think the interesting thing with how the Biden administration is framing it is they're calling out the Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps from go, you know, rather than sort of using a euphemism, you know, proxy groups or something along those lines. They're going straight for the big kahuna right away. I think that's meant to signal, as well as the size, right? The concern is with horizontal escalation, i.e. that in response to the Israeli incursions, the airstrikes that are taking place, the Iranians have been telling everybody overtly and loudly that they will proliferate, they will escalate if necessary.
But the analyst adds he has reason to believe Iran was caught off guard by Hamas's October 7 attack on Israel.
They had de-escalated the situation in line with the widely reported discussions with the Biden administration around the prisoner swap. And I think the sort of handshake agreement between the two sides is let's try and keep things at the status quo. let's release hostages, and in exchange, the United States is essentially paying Iran with its own money for behavior that it likes. Obviously, fast forward after 10/7, and things have sort of gone sideways. I think the intention, particularly with the airstrikes, with the way that the Biden administration is signaling will stop if you stop, is that everybody wants to keep this from going sideways and would like to basically try and keep this contained to Gaza itself rather than a broader regional conflict.